cows on the Isle of Wight in England for the 42nd year of the oldest and this year the biggest offshore powerboating event in the world, now the Honda Cows Classic. Over 200 competitors will be here to compete for over a dozen titles from national to world championships over the next 5 days. And first on site are the big boys, the contenders for the UIM World Endurance Championship that will be decided over 2 legs here at Cowes. And with those 2 races also being the final 2 rounds for the season-long European Endurance Championship and counting for a British endurance title, there's a lot at stake. Let's take a look at some of the range of craft involved. From Italy, the biggest boat here at 12.9 metres, the Dramatic Rizzardi, racing in the prototype class. From France, the Caldenti brothers bring another powerful monohull, this one an American-built boat, again in the prototype class. But in the touring class, look out for the emergence of the latest powerful rib technology, like this boat from Italy. And from Austria, the stunning new development boat of Hannes Bohink, for the class based on production boats, the Sport class. And the UK's top contenders, the XS Racing Sunseeker, that has outperformed many of the bigger boats in this year's European Championship already. So just a taste of the fleet, but action is what counts, and we're going straight to the start of the first race of this year's Honda Cows Classic event, and this is the lineup for round one of this year's UIM World Endurance Championship. The countdown underway, and the clock just as much a competitor as any of the boats around you in this form of classic long-distance offshore racing. Timing to get the momentum just right at the start of the race to be almost at maximum power as the green flag drops and you get a crucial head start, and certainly the XS Racing Sunseeker on the near side getting it right and into clear water, as is the Ring Drive team rib, the grey one in the middle, and that clear water, the key to getting a clear gap between you and the opposition. A good start could give you as much as a kilometre, and that could be crucial in the final reckoning. And on the far side, the vetpunk.com crew putting in the power, again finding clear water, and they surge away into the lead. And being the bigger boat, they need to. Whilst the 3 individual classes will be decided on points, the crucial overall title they're all after will be decided on index of performance, which takes into consideration the power and size of the boat, and that means even the smallest boats could win if they perform well. So, every kilometre gained, every second gained, crucial to every team. And as you can see, coming to the first turn, 3 boats who got it right have extended their advantage due to the lack of traffic around them and the settled waters ahead. And it's the Super Classic 40 boat of Tommaso Di Simone and Roberto Buonomo hitting the mark second. Then it's the distinctive grey hull, the Ring Drive team going for the clearer water on the outside, well ahead of their class competitors. And there's the Sunseeker boat, right in the tracks of Di Simone, as we look at what they've got ahead of them. There's 1 short lap around the Solent, and then it's off down around the Isle of Wight, heading down towards the Needles. A left turn there, where the English Channel waters could spring some surprises, especially for the overseas visitors. And then it'll be round again for a second lap, 121.49 nautical miles in all. And as we pick them up halfway to the Needles, it's Hannes Bohink pushing the new boat further ahead through these calm, protective waters while he can. But a glance backwards to see who's gaining. And the answer is going to be the Rizzardi team. A more powerful boat built specially for racing, moving up through the fleet now. And because they're in that prototype class, they'll have a higher performance rating and they'll be wanting to get ahead of the Austrian. But shadowing them, the Donshed designed CUV-built monohull of the Cantieri del Mediterraneo team. They're in the same class as Rizzardi. They'll be wanting to shadow them and maybe pounce on any mistakes. Meanwhile, the KS1 Sunseeker XS Racing team, Peter Dredge and Ian Sanderson, making a good start. And the other team that made a good start, the Ring Drive Rib, well ahead in the touring class at this stage. Meanwhile, the Premier Crew boat of the Earl of Normanton and David Allenby, well on their way to putting in a challenge for the world and British titles, followed by BWA Nautica, the rib of Maurizio Bulleri and Andrea Bergamini. But coming away from Needles for the first time, and it was flat calm, and that suits Bohink and his throttle man Matteo Nicolini. Now even the slightly more powerful Rizzardi will find it difficult to reel in that great head start they gave themselves. Of course, fuel conservation important too. So the 3 members of the Rizzardi family on board, Corrado, Gianfranco and Damiano, may let Bohink go for the moment. Third around the Needles, it's the second most powerful boat in the sports class, the new steed of Roberto Buonomo, making good ground. And now they've overtaken Renato Guidi, Giuseppe Salvatore, Maurizio Di Stasio and Matteo Di Stasio in the SAF monohull. They may have chosen the wrong props, expecting rougher water around here, but that's allowing Peter Dredge and Ian Sanderson to catch them in the Sunseeker. And that will fill them with confidence, although they too would have liked it rougher to outperform the more powerful boats, as they have done in the early rounds of the European Championship this year. Meanwhile, the ring drive rib, more powerful than the Sunseeker, but not making ground at the moment. But these, the concentrated faces of the SIF crew, and they've got lots to concentrate about as we pass St. Catherine's Point. Peter Dredge, the man who knows these waters better than anyone, is making a go for the inside. They set a 24-hour world record round here, so they know these waters backwards. And it's head-to-head with the more powerful boat, but Dredge has got the inside line. As they head round the coast, he's going to have the advantage, turning the corner left back to Cowes. And if the Sunseeker manoeuvre comes off, it'll help the French, now also closing on the Italians despite smaller engines. Behind them, Premier Crew, the Earl of Normanton and David Allenby in their James Beard-designed 38-foot Cougar, racing against the clock now as the fleet spreads out. And on course for a solid finish in this first leg before tackling the Cowes Torquay Cowes race. The smallest boat in the race, the BWA Nautica, starting to skip on the waves, but looking good for a second in class if they can outrun the British Hunton of Richard Bendy, Ashley Nile and Stephen Reynolds in OO Heaven. Halfway through the second lap and Peter Dredge and Ian Sanderson have moved closer. That daring run hugging the coastline has got them nearer to Roberto Buonomo, their real rival for the European title. If they can keep the more powerful boat in sight, they'll have the edge on the performance index going into the second leg. And now they'll all be thinking of that and looking to get home safely, including the Earl of Normanton and David Allenby, still running well. But up front, Bo Hink has had to push on. He crosses the line first, but he knows he's mainly against the clock. With over 1,600 horsepower at his disposal, he must outperform the smaller boats. Line honours to the Austrian, though, and at least the relief that the Rizzardi prototype is well and truly beaten. But still, they're going to come in less than 2 minutes adrift, and that could be soon made up in the long Cowes to Torquay Classic. All to play for in race two, where these times could prove the vital edge in clinching the title in the grueling 210 nautical miles of the second leg. So the endurance teams can now rest and celebrate for the moment, but join us as the party gets into full swing with the arrival of the other teams. There's the biggest single fleet of the One Design Honda Formula 4 strokes battling head to head. And it's a deciding race for all the UK national classes who've been battling all season long. And the Rib Boys will be here to settle their own World Cup title as they join the endurance boats for the Honda Cowes Torquay Classic. One of the greatest races of them all. We'll see you there. We're in Cowes on the Isle of Wight, England, for our second report from the Honda Cowes Classic. Still the biggest offshore powerboating event in the world after more than 40 years. This year, it's spread over 5 days, and last week we saw the first leg of the two races that will decide the headline competition at this year's event, the World, European and British Endurance Championships. But this year is a very special year in the great history of this event, with the reintroduction of a trophy first competed for in 1903. Originally conceived as powerboating's equivalent of the America's Cup, the Harmsworth Trophy is once again going to represent the true spirit of offshore racing. In the surroundings of the Sir Matt Aitken Museum, we caught up with the chairman of the trustees and racer himself, the Earl of Normanton.
This race is the longest running race in the world. It's going to be the 42nd running next year, and the Harmsworth, and that's got even more history. That dates back to 1903, it was first awarded, so it's coming up for its centenary next year. And I think the first race was won at 19.5 miles an hour, and the boats are now running around the sort of 80 to 90 mile an hour.
But it's the spirit of competition behind this trophy that's drawn him back after an accident that nearly killed him.
Yeah, well, yes, in 1970 I broke my back in a circuit race in Paris, in a six-hour race, and was paralyzed from the waist down for a couple of months, and came back, and did a little bit of racing in a big cruising boat where it was comfortable, and then, I don't know, everything mended, and I couldn't resist it. I had to come back and do it again. And we did well last year. We were the first outboard boat in our Yamaha pod, 38-foot Cougar, and we're running again with full Yamaha support, and we're hopeful that we'll better our seventh overall last year in the first outboard.
Well, in leg one, they overcame mechanical problems, and with a new gearbox flown in from Holland, the Premier Crew team are still in the running. Now, dozens of boats of all shapes and sizes joining in, but we'll be concentrating on the big boys. Let's meet some of the top contenders heading into leg two. Outright winners of leg one, owner-driver Hannes Bohink is looking for more fun in leg two.
For us, it is up to the weather condition. We can run also in rough condition. I like much more the rough condition than the flat, but I think tomorrow it will be flat, and the speed is very close to the prototype of Rizzardi, so we will have some fun tomorrow, and it will be a good fight, I think, for the show.
Second overall in leg one, and now leader of the prototype class, Riccardo Fattarella, is just enjoying being here. It's always emotional being involved in such a prestigious race, because it has a great history, so it's great for someone who is passionate about boats. And I'm enthusiastic about anything that floats. And of course, we hope to have a great race and that we can still win. Outgunned on outright power, but Tommaso Di Simone believes the Super Classic team can build on their third place to win. It's many years since I raced here, so it was good to get the result we did in the first race. The sea conditions were very favourable to us. It's going to be the same on the next course. Once we get round the boys at the beginning and the tricky marks, we'll be heading for the open sea, and if the sea conditions are similar, we will be okay. We are a very reliable boat, an efficient one, so with the index performance rating, I think we have a good chance to win overall, but especially our class. A steady run in leg one gives Patrick Caldenti strong hopes of a win overall, but only if conditions get rougher. We have been competing in the European Endurance Championships for some time, so we have a team here that brings to the world the maximum experience, and that will help us in this longer race. Now we can only hope for rougher conditions, and that will help us compete better in our class and perhaps win overall. Well, they certainly weren't using the full 1,800 horsepower available in leg one, but Giuseppe Salvatore is looking confident. We're pretty satisfied. It's the second time we've been here, and last year we won the world. In the first race here, we were second in class, third overall. The conditions were good, but really we prefer the sea to be a lot rougher, because we go better then than the others. All the same, we're confident of repeating what we did last year. And another throttleman hoping the gods shine on him with a bit more wind and wave is Peter Dredge.
Well, we've got reliability on our side. It's a long race. It's 220 odd nautical miles. We've got a 100% record so far this season. Hannes has got a 50% record, and Classico's failed in one race. So we're hoping that if I just keep pushing them, hopefully there'll be some rough order which will slow them down. It doesn't seem to slow us down as much. And the races we've won this year have been rough, but I think we'll be able to finish, I hope, one place back from S33, and that will be enough to secure us. There's no point in pushing any harder.
Well, maybe they could all pick up some local knowledge from the man at the helm of the Red Jet Ferry that will be our start boat.
If it's weather like this, they'll be all faster than us, I should think, so they'll be way past us. Usually, as we spectators, the things to look out for, certainly during the likes of Cows Week, can make do with the racing no problem. It's competitors are usually the thing to look out for. They're too busy looking at the interesting things going on, and until we travel very quickly, so we can be on top of people before they really know we're there. We do 35 knots, which is not a bad speed, but I think they're probably all a bit faster than us. The thing, if the weather was a bit rougher, you know, if the bit of waves, I think we'd probably give them a run for the money, because we can shoot through pretty high seas, no problem. And they kind of bounce about a little bit, start to lose speed. But I think if it was like this, we'd have a job to catch them, but we'll give them a good run for the money, I guess.
Well, running along here on one fine day in late summer, one thing, negotiating the Solent with passengers in all conditions another. He'll be glad of the break today as the boats run up alongside him, set to tackle this course. After the technical challenge of various marks in the Solent, it's then out to the open and hugging the coast as they head down to Torquay. They'll get an exact 1 hour break to refuel and set off back in almost a direct line to Cowes, a total race distance of 210 nautical miles. A true test of boat speed coupled with reliability as well, as the skill and endurance of the crews and the constant navigation makes this one of the toughest boating challenges there is. As the fleet is flagged away and the all-important stopwatch begins ticking, this is all about relative performance, remember. The bigger, more powerful boats have to finish well ahead of the smaller ones, depending on their size and power ratios. And the British rib fleet and production boats also in there, so the bigger boats will want to get clear and away. They're heading for clear water, and there's the Premier crew boat. They're getting a safe and steady start. It's a long, long race, and they'll be wanting to sound out that new gearbox. But behind them, it's a poor start for the Rizzardi team. The big wing on top, second on the first leg, and certainly co-favourites for the overall title, but now only just moving up through the fleet. But moving up to join the front pack, the Super Classic 40 team, a good start from them. Didn't have the best of starts in leg one, and had a lot of ground to make up, even on a long race that can take a lot of doing. So this time, different tactics. Well to the fore to take advantage of clear water, and certainly some glassy smooth patches out there to be enjoyed for this boat. But the SIF team, as they were saying, hoping for something a little rougher later on if their powerful monohull is to come into its own. Third in the first leg, but their big rival for the prototype title is behind them, Rizzardi, as we saw, and they'll be pleased about that. And now we see they're moving up through the fleet, reeling in the Super Classic team, and should soon be into second overall. But at the back there, shadowing them all the way, the Sunseeker XS team. Again, a monohull that performs so well and so reliably in rougher waters, as they proved in the earlier rounds of the European Championship this year. They'll be looking to finish. That's the first aim. And also don't write off the slower but reliable American boat of the Caldenti team from France, manoeuvring their way through the typical Solent traffic. And that'll be a disadvantage for the overseas visitors. Certainly local knowledge of these waters, a great help in the early stages of this race. And many will be keeping their pace down for the early stages. But there's one that's not. Confident British rib team overtaking the more cautious BWA Nautica team from the World Endurance Series. And there, the searing power of the SeaTec diesels on the vetpunk.com boat. 1640 horsepower available on tap. And on board, local knowledge being inputted by British driver Tony Gemby, a hired gun as it were, to help them stay on track. And as they round the corner to cross Pool Bay now, the battle for second place looking interesting as news comes that the Rizzardi team are running very slow indeed. Much discussion in the SIF cockpit and anxious glances over the side, but nothing to see that's wrong, so on they charge. And now they'll be looking to open her up as they get onto the bigger swells of the open waters. Meanwhile, not far behind, the twin Mercuries of a Formula One rib are giving a roller coaster ride to the crew of R69, Jamie Edwards and Ed Williams Hawks. Ed Hawkeye Hawks, as he's known, they're up into fourth place overall, really going for it. Not far behind, another UK rib, the R21 boat of Stuart Anthony, and in fact, Ed Williams Hawks' brother. They're showing the World Endurance boys a thing or two at the moment, just ahead of the XS Racing Sunseeker here. And here, a rib brandishing all the latest technology, though, the Fabio Buzzi design of the Ring Drive team, moving steadily up through the fleet, now clear of the Solent traffic, looking strong for the World Touring Class title. But up front, at Portland Bill, the pace for second place hotting up. Hannes Bohink well gone across the wide expanse of Lyme Bay as these two set out after him. Behind, it's an animated Ed Hawk, perhaps working out for his concentrating driver just how many boats are in front and just where they sit. But this rib really flying, and all due to these boys who pit themselves against anything the seas throw at them in their annual series. This the big one, the World Cup title that they're after. A glance back, and not far behind, it's the pairing of the Access Racing Sunseeker with alongside Stuart Anthony, pushing his rib all the way. But now as we get to the real open water, a spectacular picture as they round Portland Bill Lighthouse. And this is what the Sunseeker team has been hoping will be the roughest part of the trip. Stuart Anthony now giving his all. And those rally design seats with the suspension, it's pretty basic. And you have to give it your all to race at the top in Formula One ribs. But the Sunseeker now pulling away literally comfortably. Peter Dredge on throttles, Ian Sanderson driving beside him. They'll be reviewing their possible tactics as the water that greets them here in Lime Bay is absolutely flat calm. Welcome back to the Honda Cows Classic weekend, where we've been following the endurance fleet. But this Festival of Power is about more than just the Great Cows Torquay race. Hundreds of racers are here to compete for their own national titles. And racing in 4-litre, 2-litre and 1.3 classes can be as spectacular as any. Races round the bay to entertain the crowds as the endurance fleet are away. The short circuit boys get to grips with each other, but the challenge to reach the turnaround at Torquay goes on. Torquay sits sparkling in the sunshine as the harbour awaits the fleet for their 1 hour mandatory stop for refuelling. But as the boats come into sight, there's a surprise in store. Because it's not the vetpunk.com crew of Hannes Bohink, it's the Super Classic 40 team who come across the line to stop the clock first. Word comes in that Bohink has broken and the Italians are now the unexpected overall leaders. British racer John Hampton is acting as navigator.
We saw him turn round and start to head back, I guess, on one motor. And then we realised that we were hopefully going to get first place. Just have to see what happens and hope that we can, you know, maintain it. But we're only just in, 10 seconds before the next boat. So still a lot of work to do.
And the SAF team have maybe been tailing the leading boat to help with their navigation, as Renato Guidi explains. No, we went calmly along our own way, followed behind Buonomo. Obviously, it is unknown waters for us, so it was not easy, and there were many moments of indecision. We are particularly looking out to win the prototype class and keeping an eye out for Rizzardi. So if he doesn't get here, we will finish very happy. It's important for us to finish now. Meanwhile, refueling alongside Ian Sanderson in the XS racing boat, now third overall, but not hopeful, as he explains.
It's been almost 100% throttle the whole way. There's no water at all, certainly nothing to slow us down. And with the power differential that our competitors have got that are ahead of us, we can't close the gap. We needed about a metre or a metre and a half of water, and we've not even got a foot of water most of the way down.
Meanwhile, across the dock, totally pleased with their performance, the Premier Crew monohull.
No, it was wonderful, just like old times though, but the sea condition was great, flat all the way. And we had a very good race with a twin engine rib. And the Hunton, I think, we couldn't see them when we left the Solent. We slowly caught them, passed them in the middle of Lime Bay. Yamahas ran beautifully, absolutely fantastic, didn't miss a beat the whole way. And we've got a small problem with the trim on one engine, we're going to sort that now. And so we got ahead, came into the finish, and neither of us, all three of us, very close together, we couldn't find the final gate. And we all saw it at the same time. We just shot in all different directions straight to the gate. We just made it in front of them. Thrilled, absolutely thrilled to get here.
As the rest of the fleet arrive with their own class ambitions, the Sunseeker crew in the background head for their restart. And with tensions rising, it's worth remembering they're still only halfway. This time it's almost a straight run for home, but over 100 nautical miles of water between any of these boats and outright victory. And in these flat conditions, the temptation to push too fast, too soon, could be there. As they return to the water and await the countdown of their 1 hour minimum stop time, the battle of tactics recommences. The Sunseeker team, they can only hope to keep pushing nearer, and they set off after the leaders, still within striking distance in front. They just need literally a couple of breaks. And in with the chasing pack, keen to set a cracking pace. It's the 27-foot scorpion rib of Edwards and Hawks, ready to mix it with the big boys for a share of the overall honours, as well as their own class title. But first, they've got to catch the man up front, Stuart Anthony, and Chas Williams Hawks, still setting the pace. But gradually, this trio moving up, and it's the excess racing boys who are upping the stakes. It's going to be a matter of whose machinery might hold out as they close down on the SIF CUV monohull. This is the only tactic left for Dredge and Sanderson. Make the competition believe they have to go faster and hope their machinery can't take it. And indeed, Dredge piling on the power. It's been a super reliable boat for 12 months of racing and record breaking. But behind them, in the wake, the reliability of the SIF team pushed to the limit, and the engine covers immediately up in case of the danger of onboard fire. It's let go in a big way, and all that patience and tactics over the two legs goes up in smoke. And that leaves one to go, and it's this man, Roberto Buonomo, in the Super Classic 40 boat, Tommaso Di Simone alongside. But his team looking back, they'll recognise the wakes, they'll know there's one less, and they'll recognise the rooster tail wash from their arch rivals for the European title, the Sunseeker boys getting even closer. John Hampton, the British driver on board, navigating here for them, will be showing them the shortest way home, that's for sure. Meanwhile, splitting the two, a remarkable performance from the R21 rib. Stuart Anthony piling on the pressure in his 29-foot Revenger. 400 horsepower available to him, and he's making every use of it. Reliability and commitment at its best. But this is no comfortable ride for them. But as they pass Portland Bill on the return leg, two-thirds of the race done. The question is, what will happen to the leaders? Can they maintain the pace? Well, plenty of spectators in Cowes waiting to see them, but meanwhile entertained by another class of racing, powerboat's equivalent of touring car racing, the Honda Formula 4-stroke series. A one-mate category featuring celebrity co-drivers that has caught the public's imagination, and you can soon see why. Series just one of the ways that the sponsors have committed to the sport of power boating as a whole, as Martin Sanders from Honda UK explains.
Well, I think Honda loves to race. Mr. Honda always said, if there is no racing, there's no Honda. And with motorbikes and cars and Formula One, power boating is the obvious choice. And here really is the home of power boating. So the Honda Cowes Classic is a natural choice for us to get involved with. This one make series that we have at the moment, the Honda Formula 4-stroke. This is the final round of the series. We've been all around the country promoting it, and it's been great because it's the same engine, same boat, and it's all down to the skill of the drivers. And that's no different from any of the issues and that other people have when they're driving the bigger boats. It's the navigator and the driver, and it's teamwork.
Crowds remained entertaining Cowes. The battle for the long distance honour goes on. The excess racing crew passed the Portland Bill Lighthouse, having closed the gap, and all they could do now was push all the way. And the constant punishment on the rib boys was beginning to tell as they dropped into third place overall. But that was going to be good enough for Stuart Anthony to claim his title. But closing all the time, having concentrated on securing their class position, the World Touring class leader, the Ring Drive team in their state-of-the-art Fabio Buzzi rib. They now realised a podium finish overall was possibly on the cards. But the question mark was still whether Dredge and Sanderson could put sufficient pressure on the leaders for them to try too hard and to break their boat as well. And as the entrance to the Solent approached, there were going to be other local hazards that might slow the overseas team and give Dredge and Sanderson the advantage of local knowledge and local confidence. Winomo and DeSimone slowing to wind their way through the yachting traffic ahead. Could there yet be one final twist in this race? Meanwhile, forgotten but still going at the back of the fleet, the winged Rizzardi monohull had in fact reached Torquay and was quietly on the way back, and that meant they were on target to pick up the world title in the prototype category. But up front, the Superclassic 40 crew were boldly taking on the Solent traffic of all sizes. This would be a dream come true for the young designer and driver of this boat, Roberto Buonomo, and what better proving ground for this beautiful broad nose boat, sweeping lines that are so reminiscent of the boats of the 30s and 40s that led to the birth of this whole sport. And the clock comes full circle here at Cowes as Buonomo survives the Honda Cowes Classic for a remarkable victory. And in the late sunshine, the Italians can begin to rejoice, because there's not many coming home from this one. Not the roughest conditions the Cowes Classic has seen, but still a true test of men and machinery. And in the endurance category, this is how they finally finished. Sunseeker pushing all the way, but just 4 minutes adrift in the end. The Premier crew taking a fantastic third place in their outing, with Ring Drive and Rizzardi winning their respective classes. And the celebrations about to begin as the Superclassic team celebrate a great team effort. But it's the young designer, Buonomo, who's enjoying it more than most. I'm so very happy to have won the Cowes Torquay race. I'm very happy with the investment I've made in time and money in this boat as designer and driver. It's a great event to win for me. And you'll have to excuse me, because it makes me very emotional. And the honour of lifting the Harmsworth trophy goes to Tommaso DeSimone on behalf of the Italian team. A fitting reinstatement of the award. But can they defend it next year? Well, we'll be here to find out.